टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द वेदांत एजुकेशनल फिलोसफी। अबाउट द वेदांत वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन आवर प्रीवियस क्लास। फर्स्ट इन दिस डिस्कशन वी विल ट्राई टू डिस्कस अबाउट व्हाट इज एजुकेशन एज पर द वेदांत school of philosophy, how they perceive education, what is the meaning of education as per the Vedanta educational philosophy, that we will try to see. When we talk about the Vedanta school of philosophy, Vedanta philosophy, in this philosophy the knowledge is supposed to be the extremely important component of the life. They think that education is the very important part of the human life. Through the education, we can achieve everything and anything. The ultimate goal of a life also, that is the moksha, that we can achieve through the education. They think that education is the, and while explaining the importance of education, Shankaracharya says that the focal point of Vedanta is the Brahma, and that's why the Brahma is considered as the chief objective of the education system as per the Vedanta philosophy. And the Vedanta philosophy thinks that the education is the spiritual process which continues until the emancipation of the human life. Emancipation means that to getting the ultimate reality of the human life, that is known as the moksha. Till the moksha, the education continues, and that's why the education is considered as the spiritual process. And through the education we can realize the truth of the Brahma. So that is talked by the Vedanta philosophy. And we know that the Shankaracharya from the Advaita philosophy under the Vedanta, he is the one of the important promoter of the Vedanta philosophy. As per the Shankaracharya, the education is a mean of getting knowledge and eliminating the ignorance. The ultimate goal of education is to eliminate the ignorance. And that's why the Vedantis treat education as a mean of getting moksha, as a mean of getting emancipation. When we talk about the aim of education as per the Vedanta's philosophy, the one of the aim of Vedanta philosophy is the development of religious spirit, because we know that the Vedanta philosophy comes under the orthodox school of philosophy. It's a orthodox philosophy. Orthodox philosophy means they accept the religious doctrine. They accept the Vedas and Upanishads. And Vedanta is actually the end of Vedas and the start of Upanishads. It comes under the orthodox family. So one of the important aim of Vedanti's philosophy is development of the religious spirit. Through the education, the religious spirit should be developed among the learner. They should be brought into the religious belief system. They should be inculcated and they should be established in their mind the supremacy of the God, supremacy of the Vedas, supremacy of the Upanishads. That is the one of the important aim when we talk about the Vedanta philosophy. And another one is that through the education, because we know that the education have an important place when we talk about the Vedanta philosophy. So through the education, we have to achieve the moksha. So in the other way, you can understand that as and when we will be getting education, as and when we are getting education, we are coming close to getting the emancipation, that is a moksha. And moksha is a process, actually moksha, not a process, moksha is the attainment of getting free from all the material world. There is a spiritual world and there is a material world. So moksha is a process where you attain the freedom from the material world. Means the materialistic society doesn't have a much importance for the person, rather than devoting themselves to the God, to the betterment of a society, to the betterment of the mankind and a nature is the ultimate goal, those who reach to the moksha. Like that, you might be knowing that the story of Siddhartha. Siddhartha was from a king family and he started wandering and he started thinking that what is this world? What causes the hurt? And what is a way to come out? I'm not talking about here the Buddhist philosophy, Buddhism, actually it comes in the heterodox family of the philosophy. But here I am trying to explain what is the moksha. So he was wandering, he was searching the truth, and when he come to know the truth, he got the enlightenment, that is the moksha. Now the physical world, the material world was no more important for him. That is the process of getting moksha. And when you will be getting education, when you will be studying, when you will be enriching your knowledge, understanding and skills, you will be coming close to the moksha. And as and when you will be coming close to the moksha, you will be developing the self-confidence. So education, as per the Vedanta philosophy, is a process of developing confidence, self-confidence among the learner. And the ultimate goal of, one of the goal of Vedanta philosophy is developing the self-confidence. And we know that Vedanta philosophy is actually the start of the Upanishads. And when we talk about the Upanishad, उपनिषद इज कंप्राइज्ड ऑफ द थ्योरी एंड अ प्रैक्टिस प्रैक्टिकल यूटिलिटी इन द ह्यूमन लाइफ. दैट इज द वन ऑफ द इंपॉर्टेंट आस्पेक्ट ऑफ द उपनिषद्स. सो द वेदांत फिलॉसफी फोकस्ड एट डेवलपिंग द स्पिरिट ऑफ वेदांतीज नॉर्म्स. Vedanti's spirit means linking the education with the practice, with the human life, with the experience, and it should not be theoretical in nature only. So, one of the aim of the Vedanti education is providing the hands-on experience, providing the real experience, and learning by the experience. Which is also known as the experiential learning. That is the one of the important aim of Vedanti's philosophy. Another aim of a Vedanti's philosophy is development of a Vivek. Vivek is meant by the development of the reasoning ability. So through the education, the reasoning ability should be developed among the learner. It should not be theoretical in nature. It should be practical oriented. And for the practical oriented, the development of Vivek and the reasoning is very much important. Because unless or until you have a reasoning and a logical thinking power, you cannot use the theoretical knowledge in your practical life. In order to use those things in your practical life, you must have a power of reasoning and a thinking. And another one is that the devotion in the Brahma. So first, you just understand what is the Brahma, because the Brahma is coming so many times in the Vedanta philosophy. In the Vedanta, the Brahma is defined as the acceptance of ultimate reality. And that's why the Brahma is said to be the ultimate reality. And they think that Brahma is the only truth. Brahma means what? Brahma is the God. God is the ultimate reality. And God is the only truth. It doesn't matter that what is beyond that. So everything is merged in the Brahma and everything originates from the Brahma. Whether it's a soul, whether it's a jiva, ajiv, or whether it's your own thought or your own work, everything originates from the Brahma. And that's why the Vedanta philosophy talks about the devotion in the Brahma. So, till now we have seen that the aims of Vedanta philosophy. But in order to achieve those aims, there should be some modality. How we will achieve those aims? Like that, in the modern times also, when we talk about the education, we think that through the education, the scientific temper should be developed, the critical and creative thinking should be developed. Or specifically when we talk about the Mahatma Gandhi's philosophy, we say that the student, the learner should be empowered to earn after the education. The thing is, but how this thing will be inculcated? there should be a modality of inculcation, how it will be inculcated. And in order to inculcate these values, we take the help of a curriculum, we take the help of our teaching learning methods, we take the help of the assessment methods and the discipline that they are supposed to follow in the educational process. So all those things we will discuss one by one. When we talk about the curriculum, in the Shankaracharya's, that is the Advaita philosophy under the Vedanta, they consist of three types of existence. They mention three parts that should be a part of a curriculum. The first part is Pratibhamik, that is the visual existence, visual experiences. The next one is Vyavaharik, or the practical existence. And the last one is the Pramarthik, which says that the spiritual existence. When we think of this three things, first one is the visual existence. Visual existence means all the things through which we can get a knowledge, through which we can get a experience, through which we can develop our understanding. Or better to say that it's a set of experiences. So in order to develop all the aims, the student must be given an input. It may be through the visuals, it may be through the auditory learning, or it may be through the practical exposure to the field of learning. But important part is that they must be exposed to all those things, the exposure to learn. And the learning will not happen only by the lecturing of the teacher. Means the teacher will be explaining and the student will learn. As in the Vedic system it was happening, Acharya was saying and the student were learning. At that time there was a scarcity of the textual material, because producing multiple textual material was a very difficult kind of a thing. So Acharya was explaining and the student were learning, remembering and understanding the things. But in the Vedanta's philosophy, they says that the explaining by mouth of the Acharya is not sufficient, because it's a practical oriented. So they must be exposed. They must be given opportunity to work. They must be given opportunity to talk. They must be given opportunity to see, observe, and then learn. So together with that explanation by the Acharya, there are other modalities. Then the next one is the Vyavaharik, that is the practical existence. And this says that together with that, the practical exposure should be given so that they can develop a hands-on experience. If you know so many things and you don't have a hands-on experience, then that knowledge is not very much fruitful. Together with the knowledge, you must have a hands-on experience and a skill to do that. That is the Vyavaharik, practical life. And the next one is the spiritual existence, Pramarthik. And the ultimate goal of all those things, the knowledge you are getting, the skills you are developing, to be for the spiritual devotion towards the God. You should not start thinking that I know everything and I have a skill of everything. That's why I am the supreme power, supremacy. The supremacy in this philosophy is with the God, is with the Brahma. We can achieve the moksha through the education. But that will be not a replace the existence of a God. Apart from that, there is a two type of a vidya. Vidya means a knowledge in the Vedantist philosophy. One is the apara vidya and the next one is para vidya. In this philosophy, there is a two type of a concept of a vidya. One is the para vidya, another one is the apara vidya. The para vidya is related with the self-realization or the knowledge. It is the knowledge part, para vidya. Self-realization and a knowledge about the God, about the Brahma. That is the para vidya. Whereas when we talk about the apara vidya, it is related to the world. Related to the world means related to the knowledge about the society, related to the knowledge about the agriculture, related to the knowledge about the mathematics and the practical utility. So there are two types of a concept of a vidya here, para vidya and apara vidya. Para vidya is the knowledge about the Brahma. And the apara vidya is the knowledge about the world. So these things was the part of a curriculum during the Vedanta philosophy. So when you will try to understand the curriculum of a Vedanta philosophy, you will find that almost all the things was there in the Vedantist philosophy. However, it was not mentioned separately, like that we can mention the physical education, science, social science, physics, geography, mathematics, like that. It was not mentioned, but it mentions the three things, that is the visible existence, practical existence and the spiritual existence, and the two types of a vidya, that is the para vidya and apara vidya. So when you will explain all those things, you will find that it consists of all the things, like that nowadays which we have a moral education, that may come from the para vidya. When we talk about the agriculture, mathematics, astronomy, economics, or skills for performing different work, that will come from the apara vidya. So almost all the things was there in the Vedantist philosophy. Even when we think of the teaching, how the teaching was happening. So it was not like that the single memory based and the lecturing session was the method of a teaching. The variety of teaching methods were used during that time. One of the method was the listening method, obviously, because Acharya was explaining the things and they were listening and they were trying to remember. That was the one modality. Another modality was that question answer method, where students were engaged themselves in a question answer session. And they were talking about the different aspects of the Upanishads, different aspect of the real life experiences, which is also known as the Shastrarth. This is Shastrarth, the different aspect of the knowledge. And even the teaching method includes the logic and the reasoning, because one of the important focus of the Vedanta philosophy is the logic and reasoning. So that was also one of the method to eliminate the doubt, because doubt, when the doubt comes, when you don't have a proper logic for that, when you are saying something or when you are observing something, when you have a proper logic for that, then the question of doubt comes. So there was a session of a logic, reasoning to eliminate the doubts. And apart from that, there was a method of a hands-on experience, demonstration, which is known as the illustration method, where the different concepts, different things are being demonstrated by the acharya. Even a storytelling method was there for the small children to explain the concept in an interesting way. Nowadays also we follow the storytelling method for a student in a lower classes to make the content more interesting to them, so that they will be motivated to learn. Even self study and the experiential learning method, learning by doing, practical method, were also the part of the methods of teaching. So when we see all those things, we find that there was a very variety of methods of teaching. It was not a monotonous process, rather than it was a very dynamic process, and the variety of teaching methods were there, variety of a discipline was there, and the Vedanta philosophy was focused to achieve the ultimate truth and reality of the life. Here in the constructivist philosophy, we talk that a teacher and a student must have a very cordial relation, very good relation. They should understand each other. When we find the Vedanta philosophy, it also recognizes a teacher as a very important person in the society. They were respected in the all section of a society. They had a very high respect in the society. They were respected by the every person in the society, even by the kings. And they were enjoying the autonomy also. They were not under the control, full control of the kings. Like that, whatever the king will say, that the teacher is supposed to do, and the teacher is supposed to teach, whether it is a right for the student or not. So it was not like that. Now we see that the education policy are framed by the government, and that's why several times it has been alleged the government that the policy of education is to promote and propagate certain belief system that the government is endorsing. But when we talk about the Vedanta philosophy, they were free from all those things. The king, the state were not interfering in the process of education. And also, when we talk about the students, students were also very the important part of the teaching learning process. They were respected, and the student were given a equal importance to the teacher. And actually, they were the co-explorer in the journey of education. And by the student, when we talk about the Vedanta philosophy, the student were supposed to be in a self-control. Self-control means not thinking much about the materialistic world, materialistic pleasure. Self-control. They were taught, they were practicing, and it was expected to for a successful learner. And the student should have the ability to distinguish between the eternal and non-eternal objects. It was also supposed to observe from the student. And very important part in the Vedanta philosophy was that student must have a self-desire for the education. That is, you can understand like that, the intrinsic motivation for the education. If the students are interested, then the teacher can teach them. And during the education process, it was also supposed that students should perform the various activities like the religious action, spiritual activity, and the learning activity. It was also expected from the student that they should be polite and they should be fully devoted towards the learning process. हाँ दुर्गा बोलिए
सर सर आपण कहले जे थ्रू एजुकेशन आमे मोक्स पाई पर जेंति एनलाइटमेंट पाई परबा सर जदि आम पाखरे अपर विद्या परा विद्या भितरु गोटे विद्या गोटे जते ही थिबो बट आरोटा नथिबो तो हाउ वी कैन गेट एनलाइटमेंट
सी इन ऑर्डर टू एक्सप्लेन योर डाउट फर्स्ट आई विल ट्राई टू से दैट व्हाट इज द मोक्ष emancipation. When we talk about the Vedanta philosophy, moksha is the highest level of attainment through the education. Highest level of attainment. Like that, now even we say that the wisdom. Wisdom is the highest level of attainment. We focus on attaining the wisdom. है ना द लोवेस्ट स्ट्रेटा इज द नॉलेज अंडरस्टैंडिंग लाइक दैट द हाइएस्ट वन इज द विजडम एंड वी ट्राई टू अटेन द विजडम बट ऑल मे नॉट बी एबल टू अटेन द विजडम इट मे डिपेंड अपॉन देयर ऑन देयर कैलिबर इंटरेस्ट एंड द काइंड ऑफ एक्सपोजर दे आर गेटिंग सो द अल्टीमेट इज द विजडम. We are working for a wisdom, but all may not be able to get it. Like that, when we talk about the Vedanta philosophy, the ultimate is the moksha. And for attaining a moksha, different components, curriculum, methods, and so many things was designed. But in fact, that all may not be able to get the moksha. This is the highest level of attainment. Was thought and planned, and the all thing was designed in a such a way to attain that. But the thing is that all may not be able to attain the moksha. This is the fact. But it is not like that all may not be able to attain, so we should not work for that. No. Even nowadays, when we teach in a class or when you learn something by yourself, someone will be able to attain up to a knowledge level only. Someone will understand. So those who will understand will be lesser than the number of students have a knowledge. Similarly, in the next stage, analysis and synthesis. Someone will be able to attain that. But the number of students, those who will attain that, will be lesser than the understanding and again lesser than the knowledge. So it will be in hierarchical process. And all the students, you cannot expect that all of them will be able to attend the moksha. No. Like that nowadays also, all cannot attend the wisdom. Cannot means it is not like that. They cannot means not in any way they will not. It is not like that. It is like that their kind of experience, exposure, their level of analysis and synthesis, and obviously there the cognitive ability, all those things. So it depends upon the several parameters, even the modern science of teaching and learning when we talk about. So all will not be able to do that. Yes. Okay, Durga, is it clear to you?
Yes, sir. Sir, jemti Gandhian philosophy thila, sir, earning during learning. Jemti Vedant philosophy, jemti kichi, mane livelihood ko nahi kichi, jemti
I got your point. See, when we talk about the Gandhian philosophy, so Gandhian philosophy was not only limited to the earning by learning. Actually, the broader perspective of a Gandhian philosophy was that you must be empowered to earn after completing your education. Because the ultimate goal of education is that to empower you to spend your livelihood. If you have so much of a knowledge and you are not able to perform any work and you are not able to earn your livelihood, then in that way the education is not a very much fruitful. That is the one thing. So the ultimate goal of the Gandhian philosophy was to empower you. Okay. Similarly, when we talk about the Vedanta philosophy and it talks about the practical oriented learning, they should have a exposure to the real life. So it is also a way to empower you to earn your livelihood and spend the healthy life. Because you are so much devoted to the God, you have so much of a knowledge. But by only having these two things, you cannot get a moksha. Because you will have so many difficulty in your life if you are unable to earn something, if you are unable to have a real life experience of something. Practical utility of those education in your life. So you will face a lot of a difficulty and that's why you won't be able to get a moksha. That's why this Vedanta philosophy says that you must have a spiritual knowledge, but you must also have a practical knowledge. It will develop for your spiritual life, but it will also develop for a practical life. So if it is a developing for a practical life together with the spiritual life, so in that way your life will be complete. And if your life is a complete, then you will be able to spend a healthy life. So in that way, the वे ऑफ सेइंग, वे ऑफ एक्सप्लेनिंग एंड वे ऑफ अटेनिंग इज अ डिफरेंट, बट इन द बोथ फिलोसफी एंड इन द एवरी फिलोसफी द अल्टीमेट गोल इज दैट हाउ वी कैन मेक द ह्यूमन लाइफ कंफर्टेबल, फ्रूटफुल एंड enjoyable. In every education philosophy, this is the thing. Okay. Durga, is it clear to you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is there any question from anybody? Thank you for joining me today. Have a nice
time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you,
thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.